Next speaker is Alexis Bondu. He works at EDF Research and Development. That's a big powerful maker. He did his PhD at Université d'Angers on active learning by local models. And his interests are, active learning and work on the industry. And today he's going to talk about the supervised approach for change detection in the industry.
So it is a great honor to be here. Do you hear me? No? Okay, I read the speaker now. So, it is okay now? Okay. Okay?
Yeah.
So it is a great honor for me to be here, and I would like to thank the organizers. I want to present you a work on change detection in the distribution of data stream.
Excuse me,
yeah.
We can't hear you very well back. Would you speak up,
please? Thank you. Okay. The motivation at EDF is the following. We need to make a preventive maintenance. So we have to detect as soon as possible a problem on an equipment. And our objective is to avoid costly repair. And we want to minimize the period of time when an equipment doesn't work, because time is money. So we want to make equipment working all the time. So we make the assumption that this equipment is provided by a sensor that give a measurement. And we would like to assist a human expert to detect changes in the distribution of the value of the sensor. And we have also to quantify the contribution of each sensor to the detected change. For instance, in this example, the normal behavior of the system is here, before the vertical black line. And we have to detect this kind of change, and we have to diagnostic what is the sensor that is implied in the change. So we consider that measurements are emitted within a data stream. So the emitted data are called tuples, and these tuples share the same structure. In this case, it is only a timestamp and a vector of integer. The emission rate of the emitted tuples is not controlled, and the order is not controlled. So we have to take into account this particular constraint to design efficient algorithms. So the outline of my presentation is the following. I will present you a new supervised method for change detection. I will give you a lot of details on this approach, and after that I will briefly give you an overview of another approach that we have developed previously. After that I will show you some comparative experiments on synthetic data. So if you are interested, there is a reference here. So what we want to do is to estimate the difference of the distribution between the tuples on the past and the tuples that is more recent. So the first thing we have to do is to define two temporal windows. So the reference windows is fixed on the past, and the current windows is sliding and represent the current behavior, and this one represents the normal behavior of the system. So the key idea of our approach is to transpose this problem into a supervised learning task. So the tuples that belongs to this windows are added by the first class value, and the tuples belonging to the other windows are labeled by the other class value. And I have represented here the two variables. I make the assumption here I have only two sensors. And the intuition is very simple. If it is possible to discriminate both classes, that means a change has occurred in the distribution of data. And more the classifier will be good, and more the level of the detection will be important. And we have chosen to simplify this learning task because we want to reduce the time complexity in order to process a very high speed data stream. So all tuples are projected on each variable, and several univariate classifiers are trained at the same time. So it is a simplification, and we have identified only one problematic case. If there is a pattern that looks like an XOR problem, it is not possible to discriminate the classes when tuples are projected. So we make the assumption that real data stream will not evolve like this pattern. So to do that, the choice of the classifier is really critical. We need an approach with good statistical properties. And so we need a regularized approach in order to avoid overfitting. And we would like to exploit all the available tuples to learn. The learning approach must be parameter-free because it is really difficult to adjust parameters within a stream context. For instance, the cross validation doesn't work in this case. And we need a predictive model that estimates the conditional distribution because we have to estimate the distribution of each classes and estimate the gap between the distribution. So we have chosen to use a discretization method that is called the model. So I will to give you details about this approach. The discretization consists in cutting out the numerical domain of a variable into intervals. That is the definition. But in our case, the objective is to describe the conditional distribution of data. So I give you here an example. This is the iris of Fisher that are described by a single variable, the sepal width here. And each curve corresponds to the effective of each class, that is the color of curves, according to the value of the sepal width. So in this case, the numerical domain is cut into three intervals, as you can see here and here. And this partition can be used to estimate the conditional distribution of data simply by counting instances of each class in each interval. So it's very simple. And the question that the model approach answers is the following: what is the best model to do that? So first of all, the model approach is a Bayesian approach. So the best model will be the most probable one given the data. And we have to maximize the probability of the model given the data. That is say the produce of the prior distribution here and the likelihood of data given the model. And the probability of the data is constant under varying the model. So we have to maximize the produce of these two terms. So the first thing is to define a family of models. A discretization model is defined by several parameters. The first parameter is the number of intervals. And the second kind of parameters is the number of instances in each interval. So it defines the partition of the explicative variable. And it defines the bounds of the intervals. And at last, we have to describe the distribution of each variable, of each classes in each interval. So we have to make some assumption in order to develop the Bayes formula. And the first assumption is that the prior distribution exploits the hierarchy of the parameters of the model. So we have to define firstly the number of intervals, and these parameters give the number of possible choices for the other parameters. So the size of this vector and this vector depend on the value of this parameter. Okay, and at all levels of this hierarchy, all possible choices are considered as equiprobable. So it is a uniform prior, but there is a hierarchy in the parameters of the model. And the last assumption is that the conditional distribution is independent over the interval of the model. So this this hypothesis is less informative than the IID hypothesis. It is equivalent to the IID, but between blocks of instances, so it is less informative. The evaluation criterion is the following, and it is an analytical expression of the Bayes formula under this assumption. The three first terms of this formula corresponds to the prior distribution, and the last corresponds to the likelihood of data given the model. So this one corresponds to the choice of the number of intervals, and this criterion is the minimum log of a probability. So that's the reason why this criterion is additive. The second term corresponds to the choice of the bound location, and the third term corresponds to the choice of conditional distribution. And as you can see, there is combinatorics that corresponds to the number of possibility of each step. And at last, the likelihood describes the conditional distribution of that. Okay, so it is possible to easily demonstrate that the prior distribution gives a priority to simple model. So this term will be very big if the model contains few intervals. And the other term give a priority to models that fit data, even if the model contains a lot of intervals. So there is a compromise between simple interval and complex and complex model that fit the data. So this approach is intrinsically regularized. So we have defined some criterion to evaluate the change. So the criterion is the minus log of a probability. So it is also a coding length according to the Shannon theory. And a compression gain has been defined previously. This compression gain compares the coding length of the current model, M, and the coding length of the null model. The null model is non-informative and contains only one interval. So we quantify the change by the average value of the gain of the best model. This model is the most probable one, and it's called the map for maximum a posteriori. This model maximizes the evaluation criterion. And the contribution of each variable is simply estimated by the compression gain of a best model on a given variable. So now I will give you only an overview of the second method because I don't have enough time to give you more details. But if you are interested, I have all other slides and I have articles to explain you this approach in more detail. So this second approach is based on four successive steps. And there is two kinds of process. There is one process that is an online process, and it involves a very low complexity algorithm because of the rate of the stream that could be very high. And the other process are on demand, and that imply a more complex algorithm. So the first step is to summarize the data stream owing to a microcluster algorithm. This microcluster is based on the density of tuples and it evolves over time. Some microcluster appears sometimes and sometimes others disappear. And the second step is the estimation of the density using the microcluster instead of tuples. And we have adapted the Parson Windows estimator to do that. Okay, and after that, we have defined two criteria based on the feedback labeler divergence to estimate the change of distribution and to estimate the contribution of each sensor to the change. So this approach has a lot of defaults. Unfortunately, the first one is there is many parameters to adjust. For instance, the microcluster algorithm imply three parameters, and the Parson Windows estimator imply one parameter, that is the smoothing parameter of the Gaussian parameter. And in the case of data stream, it is impossible to adjust parameters because of non-stationarity, and in batch mode you can do cross-validation, for example, but in this case it's not possible, so it is really problematic. And the second problem is linked to the curse of dimensionality. In fact, the dense stream algorithm doesn't fit with dimensionality because microclusters are spherical, and if there is a lot of sensor in your stream, the microcluster will be almost empty. So it is difficult. And the callback labeler divergence imply an integral that is estimated by the Monte Carlo algorithm. And this algorithm doesn't fit with the dimensionality because the number of simulation has to increase exponentially with the dimension. So it is not a situation. Anyway, we can compare these two approaches on artificial data streams. So I have defined two artificial data streams that share the same temporal structure, as you can see here. One tuple is emitted per second. And we have defined two distributions in both cases, the initial distribution and the modified distribution. And as you can see, the underlying distribution of the data stream sometimes progressively change. And there is two transition phases, here and here. So both artificial data streams are based on two-dimensional Gaussian distribution, as you can see here. The first one implements a change in the mean, here and here. And the second one implements a change in the standard deviation. So we will see what is the quality of each approach on this kind of data. So the sum of the curves represents the level of the detection, and each color represents the contribution of each variable that is estimated by both approach. The alternative method give a very noisy detection of the change compared to the supervised method. But we can observe a threshold effect on the supervised method when both classes are perfectly discriminated. The contribution of each variable is not well estimated. But in this case, we have to look at the transition phases to have an idea of the contribution of each variable. And on the other case, so this problem is more difficult. It's very difficult to detect a change in the variance because of overlapping of both distributions. So it is a problem that is more difficult than the other. And the alternative method gives very noisy results. And this kind of result is difficult to be interpreted by a user. So it is not really convenient. And the supervised approach gives a more interesting result. And as you can see, it is more easy to interpret this kind of chart. And the detection is more clear. And the contribution of each variables are well estimated. So to conclude, the supervised method provides best result than the other, and is easier to implement because there is no user parameter to be adjusted concerning the method, and the only one parameter to adjust is the choice of temporal windows. And we would like to adapt this kind of approach for the detection of concept drift. There is a lot of way to do that, and we are actually looking at this aspect. And the supervised approach was applied on the real data sensor and give a promising result. As you can see, yeah. And this is two examples of real data sensors. And the normal behavior of the system is in both cases before the vertical line. And in this part, there is a problem, there is a change of a distribution. And this is the output of our method. So we hope that this kind of chart is more easier to interpret for a human expert than this kind of chart. So I have finished my presentation. Thank you.